every now and then I'm going back to Austin, Texas to visit family. And I have a brother who has all of his life that I can remember enjoyed telling jokes. And you'll recognize this as a stalling technique, but my brother loves to tell jokes. And when he was little, he would tell really stupid jokes. And at the end of them, he would always go, "Get it?" Because we wouldn't really laugh because it was so stupid. He'd go, "Get it?" And that would make us all laugh, right? He would just like, "Oh, good grief, Stanley." And we would start laughing. Well, now that I've been going back home to visit family, my brother, I have learned, continues to tell these really stupid jokes. So I was just back there. I got back on Tuesday night. And I try to write down these jokes. So there's a couple of them that I think are really apropos to the work that we're doing here and talking about hunger. Thus, you know that they are food related. So all of y'all that work with food or in food systems or things like that, raise your hand. Okay, so you're really knowledgeable people here. So there is a guy who was working in a turkey factory. Maybe it's a chicken. Yeah, this one was the chicken factory, sorry. Not as good as Stanley. And he, after a few weeks, he goes home and he says, "Guess what? I really learned about chickens today. I know which side of the chicken has the most feathers." Anybody?
Outside.
Oh my God, you guys are really, really smart. It's outside. Of course it is. Okay, get it? See, you always just laugh when somebody gets it. Okay, so then there's another one. There's a guy that he was working with a bunch of, he was working in a turkey factory now, and he was working in the section where they were selling the turkeys, and this woman's there, and she's like rifling through all the turkeys, and he's like, "Can I help you?" And she's like looking at every single turkey. He goes, "Can I help you?" And she said, "Well, do any of these get any bigger?" And he goes, "No, they're dead." Get it? You gotta love my brother, right? I'm just channeling Stanley. He would be so proud of me. And so this last trip, I got the one on potato land. Okay, I'm looking at about kind of the age range of people so I know which person to select in this. So, okay, so we're in potato land, right? There's a king and a queen potato, and they have a little princess potato. And one day, the Princess Potato has grown up, and she goes to her father, and she says, "Daddy, I'm in love. I want to get married." And he's like, "No way, I'm not going to have it." "No, really, Daddy, I'm in love. I want to get married." And, no, you're not getting married. Who is this person? Anderson Cooper. Absolutely no way. He's just a commentator. Get it? Yeah. Okay, and so enough of that. You're like, "Oh, please don't tell us anymore." Oh, well, no, it's not a food one, so I won't do a fun one. You want me to do one more? Okay. So there's this town. This is actually, well, okay, this is all about discrimination. So there's this town that will not serve ropes, will not provide any services to a rope. Well, there's three ropes, and they want to have a beer. There's no, all of the signs say no ropes allowed, no service for ropes. So the one rope goes, "I don't care, I want a beer, I'm going in." So he collects the money, he goes in, he goes, "I want a six pack of beer." The guy looks at him and says, "Can you read the signs? We don't serve ropes, get out of here, take your money, go." So he goes out, he's all dejected, he tells his two other friends, "I didn't get the beer." So the other guy says, "Okay, I'm gonna go, I'm gonna do this." And he like messes up the end of his rope so it's a little bit frayed. He walks in there and he goes, "I want a six pack of beer. Here's my money." He goes, "I just told your friend I don't serve ropes. Get out of here. You don't say I serve ropes." He goes out. He's all dejected. He didn't get the beer. So the third rope ties himself in a knot and he takes the ends of his ropes and he messes them all up so they're frayed, messes them both ends up, and he walks in and he says, "Here's my money. I want a six pack of beer. Give it to me now." God looks at him and he goes, "Are you a rope?" And he says, "No, I'm afraid not." I'm thinking maybe I've got another career in my future. Really, don't give up your day job. I'm just going to quit on that one. All right, so welcome everybody. I'm so glad that you're here. I'm Nancy Sasaki. Oh no, I'm not, let me think. My name is Candy, no, I'm Nancy Sasaki. I was just gonna like be incognito for having told those jokes, but anyway. I'm Nancy Sasaki, I'm the Executive Director at Alliance Healthcare Foundation. We're really excited to bring to you through our iEngageU series, this particular conversation on hunger in the community. Through our work, what we want to do is advance health and wellness, and so we try to learn from all of y'all in the community what's happening. And sometimes we're able to provide small grants to support the effort, and we wanted to look and see how, then once we give that grant out and somebody does great work and does a survey or finds some information out, how do we get that back out to the community? How do we engage you with what we're learning as well? And our Engage You series, iEngageU series, isn't just about us telling you what we've learned, but it's helping you guys to learn from each other in any way that we can. So if you've got an idea of how something you're doing or findings that you've got or something you're learning would really be a part of our Engage You series, call Michelle. Don't call me, no, call Michelle. Michelle Silverthorne is our program officer, is really the one that coordinates these efforts. But we'd love to try to help you get your information out to the community as well. So that's what our iEngageU series is about. This one is on hunger in our community. And I was just thinking about, I was gonna do this other thing about hunger. And I thought, you know, like, how old was I when I first realized that maybe people don't get the same amount of food like I get, right? And I was thinking, well, you know, when you're growing up, or when I was growing up, I was always like, you have to finish your plate, you have to finish all your food, because there's kids in India that don't get fed. And like, where's India? You know, it's like, it doesn't quite compute. And it wasn't until a cousin of mine, who was actually adopted, was talking about his family, and he said, you know, even though I was adopted at 12, he says, I can remember that there were times I would come home and all mom had left on the table were 6 apples for us, one for each of us to have, and that was our dinner. And I remember how bad I felt for my siblings, that that's all they were going to get for dinner, so I would always try to see what else I could find in the house or next door or go talk to somebody. And that's when it really hit me. That's when I really had my first kind of experience of hunger existed, and grief it exists actually in my family, and people that I know and love have experienced hunger. And so I'm sure that each one of you have that experience as well in terms of what was the first time that you really consciously got that people close to you or even in your community go hungry. So I'm excited that we could bring to you an information series on hunger in our community. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jim Foros with the San Diego Food Bank.
Thank you, Nancy. A horse walks into the bar, the bartender says, why the long face? I just thought you warmed me up. I can. Thank you, welcome to the San Diego Food Bank.
I'm assuming most of you have been here before.
You've been here before? Who hasn't been here before? Okay, so maybe even after today, if you want, we can give you a tour. We got some pretty crazy things that we're doing here. We have a repack room. We opened our, well, wait a minute, I'm stealing my own thunder. So thank you so much for being here. And my main job today is kind of give you an overview of hunger and what the San Diego Food Bank is doing to try to help hunger in our community. So I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you for Alliance Healthcare. Thank you Harder+Company, San Diego Hunger Coalition. Most of these people work for me, so thank you for showing up for work today. Anyway, so here we go. Introduction to the San Diego Food Bank. Can you hear me okay? This is really loud where I'm standing. So, San Diego Food Bank, we were founded in 1977. So we're totally a local organization, been serving San Diego County for, you know, you can do the math, for a really long time. So one of the things we try to do in trying to educate the community about hunger, a lot of people are really surprised. I mean, I'm kind of preaching to the choir with all of you. Find individuals, but you know, I'm a career nonprofit guy and here in San Diego, and I am the poster child for the misperceptions that people have about who's hungry in San Diego County. So it's been an eye-opening experience for me, and so when I educate people, when I give people tours of the warehouse, you know, I'm trying to explain to them that this is really what the face of hunger is. So one of the things, trying to make my presentations more interesting is we kind of do hunger by the numbers because it makes people, they tend to pay attention. So 476, you probably know what that number is. They estimate about 1 in 6 people in San Diego County are what's termed food insecure. There's a lot of different groups and people are coming up with different numbers, but that's the number that we're using currently. I think that came from SANDAG, and I know that the Hunger Coalition is working on some stuff that maybe that number is going to change. But ballpark, that's a pretty accurate number. 1 in 6 people in San Diego County are what we term food insecure. About 137, almost 140,000 of those individuals are children, which is really very sad. And again, that number, I've seen that number as high as 150. So again, that's one of the reasons why we're trying to pull all these groups and organizations together, working closely with the Hunger Coalition and others to try to really make sure we're all on the same page, we're all using the same stats, we're all telling the same story. So how does the food bank work? Well, it starts up here, and it's where we get our food. So a lot of different ways we get our food. One is that the San Diego Food Bank, we operate 2 USDA programs. That's about 9 million pounds of the food that we distribute every year. One of those is our senior program, and the other is the emergency food assistance program. We also get food from major food suppliers. We all know that the expiration dates on food actually are just made up by the manufacturers, so we get a lot of that great product that is still perfectly good. So we have partnerships with great major food suppliers. Food purchase, actually about 25% of the food that the San Diego Food Bank distributes, we actually purchase. We buy that in bulk. If you come and get a tour, some of you have been here, we buy these totes. They're literally 2,000 pounds full of rice, beans, oatmeal, and we repack those into 1-pound bags, and then our nonprofit partners get those. They actually buy those from us with a little bit of markup, but they're getting it on pennies on the dollar, so that's very popular with our nonprofit partners. And then food drives, and I think everybody's generally familiar with all the different food drives that we do. So it comes down to us. And then, you know, how do you distribute that much food in a year? So we do about 170 direct mass distributions that are driven by us. So it's our staff, our trucks, our efforts. So we go out in the community. This is countywide. We do that about 170 times. We could be partnered with a church group, a community group, a nonprofit, senior center, what have you. Some of the programs require our staff to be there and laptops, depending on what the service population is. Some we just have a partner and they have volunteers and we just drop off the food, they distribute it on our behalf. So that's our direct food distributions that we do every month. And then the what I like, to me, the thing I'm maybe most proud about, one of the things I brag to people the most about, is that we provide food to more than 400 nonprofits. And what I like to tell people, and something I'm very proud of, is there's really no more grassroots organization in San Diego County than San Diego Food Bank, because those are our 400 partners. Those are the boots on the ground. Those are the soldiers. It ranges from a lot of really big nonprofits that have feeding programs, Salvation Army, Catholic Charities, all the big guys that we all know about, down to little church groups that have a food pantry, and they're giving to 20 or 30 people a week. And everywhere in between. So we love that. We love our partnership with those 400 nonprofits. And we do some things to try to really work with those agencies and make them better partners. Some of you are familiar, we have a thing called Food Bank University, which meets quarterly. And we're trying to help those agencies be better at what they do. We used to just focus on, you know, nutrition and food delivery and all those programs. We've kind of tried to up our game a little bit. So now we're teaching some of these nonprofit partners about board development, grant writing, development programs. We just did one on public speaking. So, you know, the bigger agencies, they have their act together, but some of those middle agencies, they need a little TLC. And our goal is to make them better partners, and if they're better partners, then they'll be more successful, they'll be able to distribute more food, they'll be able to feed more people. So that's what we really are proud about, being a community resource. Even with those 400 nonprofits, we'll also do other capacity building. We've had an occasion where some of our nonprofit partners won't take our frozen product, our frozen protein, or our fresh produce because they don't have refrigeration or freezer units. So what we'll do is we'll go out and get a funding source and do an RFP, and we'll actually purchase refrigeration or freezer units for them. And so since I've been here, we've done that for about 25 nonprofits. So now we've built in them the capacity to take this perishable product, and now they'll take it, and then they'll be able to use it to serve their service population. So those are a couple things that I'm very proud about our agency. Food bank versus nutrition bank. We really don't consider ourselves a food bank anymore. We've really evolved into a nutrition bank. I think a lot of agencies are really on board with that. You know, nutrition-related disease linked to poverty. We know that people have less resources. They have a hard time affording protein, fresh produce, but what they can afford is high sugar, high salt, high fat. I kind of feel like I'm preaching to the choir because I see all these heads nodding. You guys know what I'm talking about. So I'll just stop right here. So we're really about that. We have some very strict nutrition policies as an agency. So we're focusing on nutrient-rich foods. We have a policy: we no longer distribute soda, no candy, no sugar, no energy drinks. We tell donors we'll accept that product, but then we're going to dump it and recycle it. So we're doing that. For some reason, the soda donations have dropped dramatically since we've stopped distributing the product. We have something, I won't go into this in great detail, it's called CHOP, Choosing Healthy Options Program. So we will grade every type of food we distribute as a 1, 2, or 3, and 1 and 2 being the healthiest, and 3 being the not so healthy. And our goal is to have at least 75% of our distributions fall in that 1 and 2 category. I think we're near about 80% right now. So we're really we're working on that again. We're trying to, if you're going to talk the talk, walk the walk. So if you're going to talk about nutrition and try to educate people about proper nutrition, you know, you need to not give them unhealthy food. 22 million, that is the amount of food that the San Diego Food Bank distributed last year, which is a lot of food. And when you come into our warehouse, this is just a small part of our warehouse. It's actually 80,000 square feet. This is supply chain at its best. You know, procurement, inventory and distribution. It's a very, very active warehouse. You bring in efficiency experts to make sure that we're being very effective. This is supply chain at its very, very best. It takes a lot of work by a lot of people, volunteers, staff, community partners, to be able to distribute 22 million pounds of food in a year. Something also we're very proud of that 22 million, over 7 million of that was fresh produce. You know, when I give tours of the warehouse and I talk to people, one of the things they're really surprised by, you get fresh produce? I mean, we're big on fresh produce. It has been about 30 or 35% of our distributions, but right now we're tracking about 45% of our distributions are fresh produce. So that's a big goal of ours. We actually expanded one of our refrigeration units so we could accommodate that. Vanessa loves it when I come up with these goals just out of nowhere. My goal is to get to 10 million pounds of fresh produce. And there's a program in California called Farm to Family, and all the food banks in California co-op together, and we're able to purchase ugly produce, stuff that's too big, too small, funny shaped, or what have you, and so we're able to get that for about 12 cents a pound. Last year we purchased about 5 million pounds of fresh produce. A lot of different programs we're doing, but this is a number we're very proud of as well. San Diego Food Bank, through all our distributions and all our nonprofit partners, we're reaching about 400,000 people a month, which is a very, very big number. Like I said, it takes a lot of people, a lot of partners to be able to make something like that happen. 28,000. When I came to the food bank, probably the statistic that surprised me the most is that we serve over 28,000 active duty military, their dependents, and veterans every month. There's definitely something wrong with that. We're very committed to the military, and we're looking at E5, E6, and below. If they're single, they're living on base, they're gonna be fine. But you had a wife and two kids, you live in San Diego, now you're living below the poverty line, and then we've learned that there's about a 30% unemployment rate among the spouses of active duty military because of the mobile nature of the military. So I'm not gonna hire this person because they're gonna be gone in 6 months, so I'm gonna hire somebody else. I had a woman in my office that was gonna volunteer, and her husband's in the Navy, and she said, when I'm applying for a job, I do not mention that my husband's in the Navy, because I know that I won't get hired. So mentioned that, we work with a lot of the military-based nonprofits, and then we do direct programs on base. Another program are our nonprofit partners, food and nonprofits. That's the program in which all of our nonprofit partners are able to get food from us. We have over 400 nonprofits. This is just a smattering of some of those. I think when I got here, we were at 330. Now we're up to about 400 nonprofit partners. So we're expanding that. We want to be all things to all people. EFAP, Emergency Food Assistance Program. This is one of the USDA programs that we conduct in conjunction with the federal government every year. That's about 5-6 million pounds of food every year. And this program, we have about 92 distribution points throughout the county. And this program feeds about 100,000 people a month. Our senior food program, that's also a program that we do in conjunction with the USDA. Qualified seniors get a 30-pound box of food and a 2-pound block of cheese. We were doing about 8,700 seniors per month getting one of those boxes, but the USDA has just allowed us to up our service population. So we're hoping to get to about 10,000. And for those of you who are working in North County, you may be familiar with Angels Depot. They had to close their doors, so we were actually part of the soft landing of that. I had met with their board chair, and so we're working really closely with them to pick up all the seniors that are no longer getting services from Angels Depot. Neighborhood distribution, that's the primary program where we distribute fresh produce throughout the county. I think we have about 20 distributions per month on fresh produce, but some of our other programs include fresh produce as well. 1733, this is probably the most shocking program, surprising program. When I first came to the San Diego Food Bank, when Vanessa was kind of teaching me about all the science of what we're doing, and she said, well, okay, we've got elementary age school kids. Their last meal of the week is on Friday. They get fed through the federal program, the free and reduced lunch program. That lunch on Friday is the last meal that they'll eat before they come back to school on Monday morning. So I had a hard time believing that. So right now, it's our Food for Kids backpack program. We give these kids a backpack of food on Friday, gets them through the weekend. Monday morning they come in, turn in the empty backpack, and the next Friday we do it all over again. So right now we're up to 37 schools and 11 school districts, 1,733 kids that are getting one of those backpacks every Friday. Sadly, I still got about 15 schools on a waiting list, so we're working on trying to chip away at that. We have 2 backpack schools actually on Camp Pendleton. So we're talking about our service to the military. That's kind of shocking. So that's the program, the Food for Kids Backpack Program. Childhood nutrition, it's all about that. I mean, you know, you've seen that kind of that phrase, if you don't eat, you can't learn. If you don't learn, you can't earn. So really, we're focused on breaking the cycle of poverty. We're not just feeding people. I think we all buy into the notion that education is a major vehicle to breaking the cycle of poverty. Well, childhood education starts with childhood nutrition. So for that reason, we're a nutrition bank. We're focusing on kids through this backpack program. Our goal is to make kids healthy so they can be healthy students, so they can get a good education, get a good job, and be able to support their family. So that's another thing that people are really surprised about. We're really trying to affect societal change. We're trying to break the cycle of poverty. And nutrition may seem a simplistic approach, and maybe it is a little bit, but we know that if we can lift people out of poverty, that's the best way to end hunger in our community. Volunteers, this is a heavily volunteer-driven agency. I mean, we have nearly 25,000 volunteer visits a year, and something like 20,000 registered volunteers. This is a very, very active program. We have volunteers in here 6 days a week, 5 nights a week. And what's cool about this, and you know, every nonprofit depends on volunteers and they're important, but our volunteers are an integral part of the supply chain. What volunteers do tonight will be part of a distribution tomorrow. And one of the things we're also very proud of is that we have 93 cents of every dollar going directly to program services. One of the reasons we can do that, the value of all that volunteerism is about $1.4 million of free labor. So our volunteers range from Brownie troops to Harvard Alumni Association. It's all team building. We get all kinds of groups that come in. But our volunteers are, like I said, a big part of our success. Food drives, generally pretty familiar with that. We do a lot of them throughout the year, but the two big ones are our summers, School's Out, Hunger's Not, summer food drive, and then the holiday food drive, November and December. We all kind of know that everybody cares about hungry people during the holidays, and in January they stop caring as much. So we try to take advantage of that and stockpile food for the next few months before we get to the summer food drive. But those food drives have been very impactful for us. North County Food Bank. Some of you may be familiar or know that back in October, I guess we're coming up on a 1 year mark, we acquired the North County Food Bank from the North County Community Services. Strong partner of ours, still is a strong partner of ours, but the North County Community Services really realized it was time for them to get back to their core mission, and maybe their expertise wasn't running a food bank. And so it was a very amicable transition, and so now we have a facility up in San Marcos. I'm spending a lot of time up in North County. How many of you guys live in North County? And so I have learned that there's a county between San Diego County and Orange County called North County. And people in North County tend not to come down here. And so actually, it's working well because now we've invested a huge amount of money in providing services up there, and the reaction we've gotten from the community up there has been really strong. It's been really great. So we're excited about that effort. We still got a ways to go. We're still trying to figure it out. The facility we're in now is not it's not really working. Doesn't have a loading dock, so we'll probably find a different facility, probably partner with some of our partner agencies up there, probably Interfaith. We're looking at doing something together. Our vision is that we could create a hunger hub in North County with a bunch of different nonprofits and kind of share expenses. So we're kind of moving towards all that stuff. You know, one of the interesting things when we started embarking on this North County Food Bank, I started getting pushback from people. There's no poverty in North County, I was told. Why are you going to North County? Well, I mean, you guys know there's a lot of poverty in North County. There are a lot of challenges that people have up there. You know, the poverty rate in Escondido is the second highest in San Diego County behind El Cajon. So there's a lot of communities up there that have, you know, there's tremendous wealth up there, but there's tremendous poverty up there as well. Just more statistics and numbers and that for you. So we, by moving up and taking over the North County Food Bank, we added another 75, 77 nonprofit partners. Now we have about 125, 130 up there. And we think we're feeding about 30,000 more people per month, although everything's moving so quickly, hopefully that number's gonna go up. We do lobbying, advocacy. We go to Sacramento, we go to Washington, D.C. There's a couple key pieces of legislation or budgeting that we worked really hard on this year. This one was an absolute home run. That farm-to-family program, the one where we get the ugly fresh produce, well, the way that works is that farmers get a tax break for all that product. Well, it was sunsetting, it was ending, and if the legislation didn't extend it, you know, that program provides 150 million pounds of produce statewide to food banks. And if that goes away, you know, suddenly we're giving away 2 million pounds of fresh produce instead of 7. So we work really hard at all the other food banks in California. We work with the California Association of Food Banks, which we're a member of. So we worked really hard on that for about 2 years, but it was passed. They extended it for another 5 years. So we, big sigh of relief on that one. This one is a big win for us as well. You know, there's a national emergency food assistance program, which we operate, but the state of California about 3 years ago created the state emergency food assistance program. So great, California. California created this great program, but they didn't fund it. So it's great to have a program, but there's no money. You know, what good is it? So first year, Speaker Perez, he had $1 million discretionary fund, so he gave it $1 million. And Tony Atkins was the speaker, she gave $1 million. And then last year, they took away the discretionary money from the speaker, so last year it wasn't funded at all. But for the first time ever, it actually was included in the budget. They put $2 million in. So what that equates to for the San Diego Food Bank is we will get about $100,000 of that money, and that's about 1 million pounds of fresh produce. So that was a big, big hit for us. Thank you to all the elected officials. And it passed both sides of the House, so I think everybody thought it was an important thing to do. Hunger Awareness Month, that's one of the reasons why we're here, in our partnership with Alliance Healthcare and Harder+Company, but this is the second year we've done Hunger Awareness Month here in San Diego. We do a lot of things throughout the month of September, so it kind of made sense to kind of give it a name and put an umbrella on it. We're doing some different promotions. We have different events going on, but we're just trying to get public awareness about the challenges of hunger in San Diego County. A lot of things going on. We're doing a special campaign with Mission Fed, and it's to raise money for the Food for Kids Backpack Program. So that's a campaign we're running with Mission Fed. Also, those of you who like music, and this is also in September, and it's actually a week from this Saturday, our sixth annual AIM Loan San Diego Blues Festival. Los Lobos is our headliner down on the water, Embarcadero North. Again, part of our September campaign, and it's a great time to listen to music and drink beer. Just be honest about it. We have different events throughout the year. Thanksgiving morning, if you're looking to burn off the turkey before you get out in the community, this is the turkey trot. When we acquired the North County Food Bank, we inherited this event. And then we have Run for the Hungry that we do with Jewish Family Services downtown. We are launching a campaign that hopefully you'll hear about, because we made this major commitment to the North County Food Bank and our efforts in North County. Well, guess what? That costs money. Nothing comes for free. So our goal is to raise about $350,000 so we can fund everything that we're doing up there. So we're launching the campaign officially on October 30th. We're doing an event in the parking lot of the North County Food Bank just to kind of kick it off, and another kind of fun event, but also a very important event. A lot of community leaders in North County should be in attendance. Facility updates. We own this property outright. That's how Irwin Jacobs and Steve Cushman got their name on the my business card. They paid off our mortgage, so we have no debt. We own this facility outright, and when you own something, you can make things up as we go. And, you know, Casey does a wonderful job coming up with crazy things to do. And so one cool thing is that Irwin Jacobs gave us $1 million last year, and so we went solar. So we have actually 1,400 solar panels on the roof. If you see a sea of 1,400 solar panels, that is a lot of solar panels. What's cool about it is it's saving us $120,000 a year. Our utility bills were about $10,000 a month. We're actually producing more than we're using. And we have an equation that we can take $1 and leverage that into 600,000 meals. So that's saving us the equivalent of about 600,000 meals per year. And this is really cool. And for those of you who don't want a full tour, but when we're done, if you want me just to take you over there and show you this, this is like technology I'm not even sure I'm smart enough to understand. We are a zero waste facility now. We were putting 600,000 pounds of refuse in the landfill every year. Two pieces of machinery right there. This one right here is called Turbo Digester. And we take food product and we do wet loads or dry loads. The wet loads, literally it's cans of product that are sealed. The food is still in that can. It crushes the can. The food gets squeezed out of the can, goes this way. The paper metal go that way. That metal can is curled up in a little ball, which will recycle that. That food waste goes into a big, huge bin, which is really gross. And we mix that with wood shavings, like you'd see in the bottom of a guinea pig cage. We mix it together, and it goes into that vessel on the right. That's the composter. That's actually about 75 feet long. It rotates. It heats the product, kills all the pathogens, and we make finished compost in 5 days. Now, somebody really smart here is going to say, well, what are you going to do with all that compost? Well, you know, we got 400 nonprofits, many of which we have community gardens, so guess where they're going to get their compost for free? They'll get it from us. So to me, that's kind of a cool story. Kind of take it full circle. You go from food waste to compost to fresh produce. So that's pretty cool. And we're still working out the bugs, but we're producing compost. We're also creating a new volunteer and event center. That'll be in the far east side of the building. Grand opening, hopefully, within 6 or 8 months. We're about halfway through a couple of our phases. We'll have a separate entrance for our volunteers. So we're working on that. And that is the food bank and North County Food Bank. So thank you very much. Now what I'm really excited about is I get to stop talking and introduce a great friend and partner. First met Anna Heed when she was at Leechtag, and then she came over from the dark side to the nonprofit side, and she's now the executive director of the Hunger Coalition. So here's Anna Heed.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you. Food Bank and to Alliance Healthcare Foundation for inviting me to join you today with Hunger Action Month across multiple organizations countywide. So you'll see that we are using different names, but we're trying to, Hunger Coalition's trying to create sort of an umbrella for all the activities. So what we'll look at next year, maybe we can call it the same thing. September, okay, so next slide, or should I? So just quickly about the San Diego Hunger Coalition, we were founded in 1974 to help coordinate local food drives around Thanksgiving, and in 1975 we were involved with our first advocacy campaign, which was to allow grocery stores to donate our damaged food to food pantries. In 1977, one of our lead people was at the table when the San Diego Food Bank was launched. In the 80s, we switched our focus to federal nutrition programs. And in 2005, when our food stamp utilization rate, or CalFresh, as we call it in California, was one of the worst in the nation, the San Diego Hunger Coalition launched the CalFresh Task Force in partnership with the county to see what we could do about that. So in 2006, we got a grant to hire our first paid employee, which is pretty crazy. So 32 years volunteer run, very grassroots. Today we have 4 programs and a staff of 8 as of today. First new staff person started today. We have a new mission statement. Our mission is to lead coordinated action to end hunger in San Diego County, supported by research, education, and advocacy. We have 4 programs, and in each of these program areas, we lead a collaborative table. So in the area of CalFresh, we lead the CalFresh Task Force. In the area of school meals, the Summer Meals Task Force. Public policy and advocacy, you may or may not know that the Hunger Advocacy Network just transferred over to our organization as of July 1st. And Hunger Free San Diego, which is an initiative I'm gonna tell you just a little bit about. And at that table, we've got the Hunger Free San Diego Advisory Board, which Jim is a part of, and Vanessa also. So this is our approach. We do not provide direct service. Same way that the food bank tries to raise all of its partners through capacity building, technical assistance, best practices, we're looking at the whole landscape of food assistance across all of the different types of distribution. So we do training and technical assistance. We're trying to increase participation in CalFresh and expand school meal programs. For example, we want to see every school in the county offering breakfast, and they're not all doing that. We educate policymakers and the public. We advocate for legislative and administrative policy changes. We provide research and leadership to build a more effective and interconnected system of food assistance resources. I should mention that our chair of the Hunger Advocacy Network is on the San Diego Food Bank team. It's Daniela Solana. Hunger Free San Diego. So what is Hunger Free San Diego? A collective impact effort to end hunger in San Diego County, again, through an interwoven safety net of food assistance resources. So what do we mean by hunger free? We're not trying to address the root causes of hunger, we're trying to meet the need. We feel that it's our job to provide the food, to align with other programs that are advancing people's self-sufficiency, but people need food all along that path, and so we, as the food providers, need to make sure that that we're doing our job. Who's involved with Hunger Free San Diego? More than 30 decision makers and leaders from across the whole food distribution spectrum. Timeline, we're in the research phase. I won't go too much into it, but basically we're trying to understand what are we producing today, how much money is it costing, kind of the groundwork, so that in the next phase, we can all come together and figure out how can we end hunger in this region by the year 2030. This is one of the pieces of information that I'm very excited about being able to produce for San Diego County. This is from Indianapolis, but we're gonna be doing the same thing. And we're just looking at number of meals. Where are they coming from? We think this is important for all of us in this sector to understand, and it's very important for the public and our funding partners to understand as well. So, Hunger Action Awareness Month. The Hunger Advocacy Network, which I briefly mentioned, it's a collaboration of about 20 agencies. Many are in this room today. So we have put together a social media toolkit and asked people if they're interested. So every organization has its own plan. So you heard about the food bank's plans for Hunger Awareness Month. So this is actually a national campaign. And what we can do is, this is the month to lift up stories of those struggling with food insecurity using social media. So as all of you within your own organizations have your own campaigns and events and things that you're listing, if you use the hashtag HungerActionSD, then we're all part of the same conversation. So think about sharing your stories, your client stories, highlight a volunteer, promote your own events. And by reposting your partners' posts using HungerActionSD, it amplifies our collective voice. So this overarching plan, if people want to join in with us, the first 10 days basically announcing that it's Hunger Action Month, talking in general about hunger in our community, throwing out some stats. Our toolkit has statistics that you can use. Next week, no child should go hungry. So let's really talk about the extent of child hunger in San Diego County and raise awareness about that. The following week, access to food at any age, seniors. It's also the same week as the CalFresh Challenge, which I'll talk a little bit more about. The week after, serve those who served us. Jim talked about military hunger. It's a real problem here. We have a huge military population, and this is something that people are shocked to learn about. CalFresh Challenge. So this is the seventh year that the Hunger Coalition has hosted this event. Can you feed yourself on $4.27 a day? That's the average CalFresh allotment per person. So we invite you to join us for a one-day challenge on Monday, September 19th. If you join us, tweet, post, get your friends involved. If you're really up to it, see if you can make it a week. Share your experience using hashtag CalFreshChallenge, hashtag HungerActionSD. You can fundraise for this effort. All money raised through the CalFresh Challenge will be used for the CalFresh Task Force. And you can sign up on our website. It's very easy. We've got this nice new page for signing up. Fundraising is optional, but it really is an interesting experience. I did it last year for a week, and I was able to buy enough food, but it meant that I ate the same thing pretty much every single day. So that's not something that you can get your kids to do. That's not a realistic thing. It also meant I had to cook everything from scratch, which also was not so realistic for people. I mean, it's really interesting to go through the process. I encourage you if you haven't done it before. Another piece that the Hunger Advocacy Network is doing with its partners is the paper plate campaign. So we go to food distributions and partner up with our agencies and ask people who are there if they would be willing to fill out one of these plates. In the end, we send them to the elected officials from their district. So also, we're putting this together in an art display. We're going to show it at Liberty Station on Friday night if you're interested. So I don't know if you can see this, but why do you come to food distributions? So I can be healthy. What would happen if your CalFresh benefits were cut? We wouldn't have as much fresh vegetables and fruits as we do being in the CalFresh program. What would you like your elected officials to know about hunger? Food stamps, EBT, sure helps get us through, thanks. What would you like your elected officials to know? It affects everyone, even the college educated. Why do you come to food distributions? I'm on SSI and can't get food stamps. I make enough to barely make rent. It's pretty moving to hear the stories. A lot of you work directly with people who are struggling like this. But we're going to turn all of these plates into a photo essay that's going to be on our site, so you can just flip through and read through them. So that's it. If you'd like to get more information about the CalFresh Challenge, then go to our website or contact Marcia, who's our CalFresh coordinator. If you're interested in the social media toolkit, you can email me or email Diane, who's the Hunger Advocacy Network manager. Thank you.
You only have me for like another 3 minutes, and then you can, anyway, you don't have to worry about that. Okay, so why are we here? Well, you know, Alliance Healthcare, wonderful partner of ours, and we're really, you know, San Diego Food Bank really prides itself in organizational excellence, and we've always done a very great job, good job of strategic planning. We always have a 5-year plan that we update continually, and our agency is actually taking it a few other levels in the last year and a half. We did contingency planning, and now we're starting to do scenario planning. So again, we're always trying to push the envelope to make sure that we are the most effective, efficient organization that we can be. So all of you sitting here today is kind of part of that culture that the San Diego Food Bank has. So why do we want to partner with Alliance Healthcare? Well, you know what? We wanted to improve on our strategic plan. It's great for us to sit in a room and come up with a lot of ideas, and we think we know best. Maybe we do, maybe we don't. So we want to get input from a lot of the different stakeholders. And we want to make sure that the data that we're collecting is the right data. And we want to be able to measure that. And I think all of you and Amy who are, you know, program-based people, your background's programming, you know it's all about measurements, because you want to evaluate, are we being effective, are we being efficient, are we doing a good job? And then if a program is not being successful, then you know, okay, we need to change the program because what we're doing, maybe it's not working as well. And then also, obviously, everything we do needs to be funded. And if our funding sources aren't happy, and if we can't show the results of their investment, then we're not going to get funding. And if you don't get funding, then none of the programs exist. So we want to make sure we're doing good programs, and we want to make sure that our stakeholders know that we're doing good good programs. We also want to get feedback from our stakeholders, kind of what I was saying. We want to make sure that the people who we work closely with, our agencies, our board members, our volunteers, our staff, all are part of that process, because that's an important part of our success. So in doing our organizational capacity assessment, we needed a neutral party. We don't want to do it ourselves. We want to have somebody else come in that's objective, that is Switzerland, and that they can, you know, tell us what time. She's looking at me, kind of funny. So we brought in Harder+Company. And ironically, I had met somebody from Harder+Company probably 5 years ago when I was working for the San Diego Burn Institute, and I kept that business card, and somehow I was able to find it. I was talking to Vanessa, I think I know this group called Harder+Company, maybe they can do it. And then Vanessa had actually met somebody from their staff as well, so I guess it was all kind of meant to be. So we partnered with Harder+Company, and they came in, and we did assessment, we're working on measurements, and I think it's been a great process for us to kind of look inwardly and see how we can do a better job. So without any further ado, I have the pleasure of introducing Courtney from Harder+Company, and she's a lot smarter than me, so she will take it from here.
Is it working? Well, thank you everyone. I just want to thank Jim and Anahi for providing those introductions, some background about, you know, why we're here today. And for those of you that don't know, Harder+Company is an organization that works with both public and social sector organizations around San Diego, across the state, and nationally. But we're really helping organizations learn about their impact and to develop strategies to advance social change. So in doing that, Jim kind of introduced, Jim introduced some of the background of why we started working with the San Diego Food Bank. So we listened to some of the reasons that they applied for funding through the Alliance Healthcare Foundation. So that was both to look internally at their capacity, to both inform their strategic plan and thinking into the future, and then also to look more specifically at some of their programs and the impact that those programs are having. So you heard earlier, Jim, talking about the Food for Kids backpack program and also some of the nutrition education programs. So today we're going to go a little bit more into detail about exactly what we did to take a look at these programs and to talk through how we can measure impact. And we also were able to document the process so that, thinking into the future, the food bank can use some of these strategies that we develop, processes, to go through the same process with other programs. So the first thing we worked on was an organizational capacity assessment. So this was a tool that's been developed for nonprofits to use to look at their organizational capacity. So what we did is we adapted the survey for the food bank, and we programmed it online and had all of the staff at the San Diego Food Bank participate in the survey, including the leadership staff and the board members. So the assessment focuses on these six dimensions that you can see here. And this is what we ended up, kind of the result of this assessment. And I'm actually going to pass it to Vanessa in a second to talk a little bit about what they learned from it. But this is a way to look at, you know, what level of capacity everyone in the organization thinks they're at for specific dimensions. So for this one, we're looking at aspirations and strategy. And you can see we asked about mission and vision, all the way down to program development, education, and outreach. And you know, Vanessa will go into a little bit more detail, but really the food bank used this, you know, presented this to staff and board members, and it also helped inform some of the planning and thinking as far as strategic plan and moving forward. So Vanessa, you want to add on to that?
Sure.
And some of your findings, what you learned?
Yeah, overall, the process that we went through for organizational capacity assessment was fairly simple. It was a very nice rubric here of 1 to 4. I think overall, we ranked at about a 3.4, so above average overall. But there were a lot of learnings that came from this organizational capacity assessment. It had been a while since we had reached out to our stakeholders to learn about where they thought we were as a food bank. And we learned a couple of things. So one, sorry, we are an active warehouse here. So one of the things that we learned, first and foremost, is that one shoe does not fit all, or one size does not fit all, sorry. And what that means is we use the same survey for our staff and our board members. And I remember still in our board retreat, we had a few board members say, you know, the survey was great, but it was too high level for us. We didn't know what some of the answers were, and so we just assumed it was good. And then, of course, when you're surveying anyone, you don't want any assumptions. You really want to know what their actual perception is. And so, future-wise, we would love to recreate the survey, but make it more so that we're able to really focus on the different departments, and then also create a separate survey that would be more high level for our board members to give good feedback to us on. So that was really, really great to learn. And then the other thing was when we did the staff survey, we were getting some commentary back that mentioned, well, we don't know about some of the marketing that's being done, or we didn't know about some of the measurements, some of the measuring tools that you guys are doing at the food bank. And we, on the management team, we knew a lot about that information, but we realized that we weren't communicating that as well throughout the entire organization. And so it was a great wake-up call to say, you know, share everything throughout the entire organization, because people do care, and it's important for them to know that. And lastly, it was nice to get feedback and to see that our strategic plan was actually right in line with what some of the results were. You know, sometimes you're a little scared when you're putting out an organizational capacity assessment to your board and all your staff. You're kind of just waiting around to hear what's going to come back from it. And I think we were really happy to see that it was in line with our current strategic plan. We had to make a few adjustments, but nothing too dramatic. So overall, it was a really, really great experience. I would highly suggest that you do, if you haven't already, do something similar within your organizations just to get the foundation to where you are, especially if you're in the midst of either doing a new strategic plan for the first time or you are already in the midst of your fourth or fifth year and you're looking to redo a new strategic plan. This is definitely a great exercise to go through. And Harder & Company made it very easy for us because, as Courtney mentioned, it was just clicking the buttons, and then they came back with a very user-friendly results report, which we were able to share with staff and our board.
Great, thank you. So we want to keep this really fluid and have you guys ask questions at this point before we move into program evaluation, and we've been talking at you for a while. So are there any questions, and that can be for anyone that's talked so far, whether it's about some of the background that Jim or Anahi gave, or about the organizational capacity assessment?
One smart question out there.
One, or any ahas, any interesting thoughts, something you learned? Yeah.
Yeah, we don't get a lot of it, but we do get frozen fish that has been repacked after coming back from sea, but it's not very much. Do you have fish that you would like to source and donate to them? We will accept it. We have a large freezer. Okay, great. Let's chat afterwards.
Yeah.
You said about the numbers, telling the story, that same story with the numbers. Are those numbers for the stories that you tell inside your organization, or are those numbers shared and you and your partners share that same story?
Like the 476?
Yeah.
I think that came from SANDA. So I think that's one, that's a number that most agencies are using, is that 476 figure. It's people living under the below the poverty line and what have you. So we depend a lot on groups like SANDAG. We actually have just developed a new relationship. There's an entity called the Center San Diego County, the Office of Business Intelligence, and they do a lot of that. So we're actually working with them. We brought them in, a large group of them. And so we've asked them specifically some of the stuff that we're looking for, because they have all that data, but you know, they maybe haven't put it together quite the way we want it. So they're actually working on that for us right now, so we can start looking at what our service population is, especially up in North County, because we had some naysayers that said there wasn't any poverty in North County, so we wanted to get statistical proof. Yeah, there's poverty in North County. So, but you know, one of the things you all know in this community, there are a lot of smokestacks. There are a lot of agencies trying to do the kind of same thing. So we're really trying to do, working with the Hungry Coalition and others, trying to bring it all together so we're all telling the same story, we're all on the same page, going in the right direction.
Yeah, I think there's another question here.
Yes. So for a school to be qualified, they have to have at least 85% of their students enrolled in a free reduced lunch program. And I think the schools we're in are probably what, 95% of the kids are enrolled. So yeah, we have a waiting list of 15 schools. And just when I start bringing some off, Danny keeps adding some more on. We'll get a very kind, generous donor that wants to work to get a school off of the waiting list, but I got to make sure that I raise the money for the 37 schools that are already on the program, because we don't want anybody to fall off and have to go around the line and come back. So really gradually, I think when I got here, we were about 1,300 kids. So we're adding about 100 kids every year, which tends to be two schools. And so we're up to 37 schools at 1,733. And check back with me in a year from now, and we'll probably be 100 more. And then we've had some groups that say they want to adopt a school that's in their area, which is fantastic, but then we're asking them to commit to long-term funding. We don't want you to just say, oh, this is kind of fun, let's do it for a year, and then say, okay, we're pulling our support somewhere else, because that doesn't, because we, once we add a school, we never want them to come off the list. So we're careful about that, but I mean, if I had a big donor that said, here, I'm gonna fund all of those 15 schools, it's about 10 grand per school for one 36-week school year, so if somebody comes up and gives me a long commitment of funding, and we'll pull those off right away. Pretty accurate. You taught me well.
Yeah.
Do you have a path for community or client feedback for your direct service program?
Oh, so so that was another thing, and I'm sorry, there were a lot of learnings that came from the organizational capacity assessment. We definitely need to broaden our stakeholder survey. And I'm actually glad that we did not reach out to all of our partners yet, because after getting the feedback that we got from our board members, the survey would have been way too high level. I mean, we even had staff internally who were like, oh, I don't know about your governance and your board and financials. And so we do plan on doing a step two before looking back at our five-year strategic plan, which will include all of our partners. So that is the next step, definitely. But it will probably be pared down. The survey took about 45 minutes to complete. So it was a fairly long survey. It was very detailed. The one for the partners, and I know the face that you just made, the one for our partners is going to have to be, you know, 10 questions, ABC, 5 minutes, yes. So that is the next step. So be on the lookout.
And has anyone else ever done an organizational capacity assessment or something like that?
Yeah.
So you've used that within your organizations as well. All right. Any other questions before we talk? Yeah.
On staff. So she overlooks and over all of our programs and nutritional quality of our programs. We've actually started some programs, and I don't know what the acronym SANDAS stands for, so you can tell them all about that.
So can you repeat the question for me one more time? Do we care about nutrition? Yes, we care about nutrition. Nutrition education. Yes, and we'll talk more about our nutrition education programs in a minute when we get to our program evaluation. But we have a few different grant programs that are going on right now. So we provide nutrition education. We funnel it through our nonprofit partner agencies, so we are always accessible for them if they have, they need recipes, if they need assistance in nutrition. We have a senior nutrition class that we do ongoing that's free to the community. And so those are 6-week-long classes that we provide to our seniors. We can do cooking recipe samplings, tasting demos, anything and everything. So we're here as a service to our community to reinforce that, yes, you do need that healthy food, but let's teach you that one step further. How do you actually consume that? How do you make those healthy decisions? So yeah, we're on the docket for that nutrition education. They can always call the food bank and ask for nutrition assistance, and then we can get them plugged into the right avenue. So we also provide nutrition education for the Food for Kids side, so we have kids nutrition. We can refer them to CalFresh to get that assistance and then pair that as well. So they can always call the food bank. That might be the easiest way to suggest that. One of the fun programs that Callie is going to be implementing, there's a national program called Cooking Matters. And one of the components to Cooking Matters will include taking tours of our local supermarkets to show people, you know, kind of shop around the perimeter, stay away from the middle aisles, and then we'll hopefully be working with some of our big partners like Bonds to provide gift cards. One of the challenges at the very end of the course is that they take their $15 or so and they buy healthy foods to make meals. And so that will be something that Kelly will be starting up. So if you have anyone that's interested in helping and volunteering, we can always use that assistance as well.
All right, any other questions before we talk a little bit about program evaluation? All right. So I'm gonna go back a slide here. And so we wanna talk a little bit first about why the Food Bank selected, San Diego Food Bank selected the programs that they did to work with us on, to think about impact, think about strategies to measure some of, you know, what they're doing. So I'm gonna pass it over to Vanessa again to talk about that.
The food bank, we run about 7 different programs. About 2 of the programs are government funded, so there's very strict guidelines that we need to follow. They basically tell us what to report, when to report it, and why. We decided to pick a couple of programs that we have been working on that receive no government funding, and we've been getting a lot more advice, recommendations from funders on what to collect. And so we felt that it was important to make sure that the program and its integrity remained with the food bank, and we wanted to respectfully value our donors' wishes and with their opinions and their recommendations on what to collect by gathering research that would help us to determine whether or not what they're asking us for is a true factor of measurement, and really, will this one item determine whether or not this program is successful or not? So we picked two programs. Our first is our Food for Kids backpack program. Just some examples, we had funders asking us, well, show us that their attendance is improving in the school. And we just felt, well, maybe that's not the only method of that alone is a great success for the program. The other one that we picked was our nutrition education program for many reasons. We have experts that would like us to collect additional information that, again, we didn't feel was the only form of measurement for that program. And so this was a really great way to use Harder+Company as our third-party research organization to come up with whether or not those forms of measurement were accurate. And if they were, great, we'll continue or we will start using them. And if they're not, then maybe we can add that to our responses when we're reporting back to some of these funders. So I'm sure all of you have had experiences like this before where you have a funder that's really in love with your program or has worked closely with you on your programs and wants you to start collecting data and information. But really, you have to make sure that you are sticking with the integrity of your program and that you are collecting the right data. You're not just collecting data for the sake of collecting data. Daniela Solano is, or Murphy, sorry. Congratulations, by the way. Daniela Murphy, she is our Food for Kids program manager. She also oversees our CalFresh outreach program and our Food for Kids and our senior food program. So she's in charge of all the direct services that we have here at the food bank. And then Callie Burst is our nutrition education, nutrition wellness coordinator. She is in charge of all the different programs that we have within nutrition education, including working with all of our interns and volunteers who want to help provide those recipe cards and the cooking classes that we do for seniors. So the two of them are going to go into a little bit of detail as to how this information is helpful for them and their program specifically, and then talk about how we plan to use those moving forward.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Daniela, and as Vanessa mentioned, I do oversee the Food for Kids backpack program. Just to give you a little bit of background, the backpack program was implemented in 2006, and I believe there was only 150 students at two different school districts. And today, in 2016, we're going to be at 37 different schools, 11 different school districts, and now we're going to be serving 1,733 students. So you can definitely tell the growth of the program. It's one of the programs that generates a lot of interest from the community, and as the program has grown, there's a lot of donors that are really interested in supporting this program. And so by getting those funders, they want to know, well, what is the impact, and Vanessa had mentioned on attendance, and it is a contributing factor to attendance, but that's not only the impact that the program is having. So by having a Harder+Company kind of evaluate the program, kind of create a framework with very clear objectives, it allowed us to better measure what it was that the program was doing and the impact that it had on the families and the children.
So as Jim mentioned before, my name is Callie. I'm the dietitian here at the San Diego Food Bank. We chose to work on the evaluation of our nutrition education programs to effectively measure our impact. So it's really important to know whatever program you're putting into place that you're actually measuring what you need to measure so that you can report back to your funders to say, this is what we're doing, this is how well we're doing, please give us more money. So we recruited Harder+Company to help us specifically with our senior nutrition classes. So these are 6 weeks of 1 hour nutrition classes, and Harder+Company was able to help us rework our pre-test and our post-test so that we could see any changes with our clients. So they were able to provide us with that framework so we could clearly see what our objectives were, so we could report back, making sure that we're teaching what we need to teach. We have included more validated metrics, so these tools have been used in previous research and other programs so that we know the data we're getting is very high quality. And again, this is really effective when we're reporting back to our funders to make sure that we can say this is how well we're doing, and also compare that with other programs and other research that has been done in this field as well.
Thank you both. So now I just want to talk a little bit about some of the details of what this process looked like with us working with both Daniela and Callie and also Vanessa. So The first thing we did was to clarify the goals and objectives for each of the programs. So what is each of these programs really trying to do in order to, you know, we need that background information to develop measures that would best capture that information. So we then reviewed some of the existing data collection instruments. So both programs already had some data that they were collecting. As Callie mentioned, we helped adapt the survey that they had already been using as part of the nutrition education classes. And for the food backpack program, we were able to look into some other tools that other food backpack programs across the country are using to pull some of those ideas to bring into this evaluation. And so that goes into also conducting a literature scan. So what are other programs out there doing that are doing similar work? How are they measuring success? Reporting to their funders, all of that. So we were able to find a lot of great information about similar programs, especially the food backpack programs, because they're going on across the country. So the next piece is identifying process and outcomes measures. So process measures are more of those numbers. So how many pounds of food, bags of food are being distributed, how many kids are being served, how many seniors are being served. And then the outcomes measures are more of those, as Callie mentioned, a pre or post survey. So looking at changes in knowledge, behavior, are seniors participating in the program learning something over those 6 weeks? Are kids saying that they enjoy the program? Are they satisfied with the food that they're getting? Do they have any recommendations for changes? All of these things the food bank can then look at to address the program, see if they need to make any changes to really increase that impact. And then we provided some recommendations for setting targets. So when you're first going through this process, it doesn't always make sense to set targets. I think Jim mentioned earlier that they are thinking about 100 new students a year. So that's something that we include in this, is thinking that that's a goal to strive for and updating it on a yearly basis. You know, you can also say that if you've looked at the literature and you can say that we're hoping for 85% of seniors that participate in the program will show increased knowledge about health and nutrition, things like that. That depends on funding, how long the program will be going on. There are a lot of things to consider when setting targets. It doesn't always make sense to do so. And then we finalized evaluation frameworks. So this is an evaluation framework that kind of puts all of this information in one place and maps how everything is, how everything that we're collecting is addressing the goals and objectives of the program. So I'm just going to show a couple of snapshots. So this is the survey, the pre-survey that we worked on. As I mentioned, Callie had a bunch of this information before, but we were able to find some measures about food insecurity, as well as some metrics around monthly budget based on the populations that they're working with. Well, it makes sense for some of these answer choices. This is what the first page of the evaluation framework looks like. As I said, we have kind of the overview of how this, first of all, how this program fits in with what the food bank is doing overall. What are its goals and objectives? And then moving into, you know, some of those process and outcomes measures on the next page. And that's what something like this comes at the end, where we have the objectives, so to increase access to food for chronically hungry children. How are we going to measure that? You know, we might have a student focus group, parent survey that we developed. And then this is something that can be reviewed on a biannual basis, whatever makes sense for the program, to see how well you're addressing those overall objectives for the program. So before we have any comments or questions, Vanessa, is there anything else you wanted to talk about as far as how you plan to use this? I think Danielle and Kelly might add on as well.
One thing, in fact, our grant writer just came up to me today. So one of the things that we were experiencing with our nutrition education program is we had a particular funder who wanted us, felt very strongly that we should collect BMI measurement from every single senior who goes through our senior education teaching program. And for one, getting a senior to get on a scale on the first day that you meet them, I mean, I can't think of anyone that would want to do that. So there's an uncomfortness of putting someone in that position to begin with. But then number two, in some cases, our seniors don't need to lose weight. In some cases, they need to gain weight. And so we felt that if we provide BMI measurement for all of our seniors, and the results are that maybe they were too high or too low, and our program is being judged on the success of that one measurement, we just didn't feel like that was accurate. And so that was one thing in particular that we asked Harder+Company to research and to tell us, are we wrong? You know, is this donor right? And should we be collecting this information? And in fact, it did come back that that was not the right form of measurement for the type of program that we're doing. You know, maybe if there's one-on-one consultation, and I know Callie can speak a little bit more to this, then we can, that can be one of the leading factors, you know, your BMI being higher or lower. But for a 1 hour, once a week, for 6 week classes to say that BMI is going to increase or decrease was just not something we felt comfortable with. And so just today, Mike Minhar, as our grant writer, came and said, in the report that we're sending out to this funder, I put in there that, you know, thanks to the research from Harder+Company, it's a third party entity, it didn't come from the San Diego Food Bank, this is not the right form of measurement, and this is why, and if you'd like more information on that, we have a whole research on why that is not. So it's a respectful way of pushing back a little bit when you feel very strongly about how your program is being measured and what you really want to base success on. So that was a really great point, and I know, Callie, you probably
Yeah, just to add to that, thank you, Vanessa. So like she said, BMI, body mass index, may not be appropriate for this population, which we learned from the literature review that Courtney and her team did. We were able to learn what our scope was for our program to know that we could focus on behavior change, knowledge, so now we can utilize this information and cross-reference that with other groups that are using this evaluation tool, these two questions. And so we know what we're focusing on, we know where our strengths are in this program, and we can report back on that. And then potentially we can partner with other groups that are collecting these biometric measures like blood pressure, BMI, diabetes, blood sugar screening. So we can focus on our strengths and then potentially partner our programs with other groups that are collecting this information.
And I think with Food for Kids, you know, we talk about attendance and academics, but one of the objectives is, you know, providing consistent food over the weekend. So it's really that consistency, so making sure that the child goes home with food, as well as a family, because we do provide a supplemental food bag for the families as well, because if the child is insecure, the family is probably insecure as well. And so I think now with the survey that was created, one of the questions on that survey is, you know, is the family worrying less about food? And I think that was one of my favorite questions on there, because it is through the backpack program that the families will be worrying less. So it's like, you know, Vanessa said, it's not just academics and attendance. There's really more to the impact of this program.
So I know that a lot on our Food for Kids program and our nutrition education program, but really the beauty of the framework that Harder+Company was able to put together for us is universal. So the plan now is to use the same framework throughout all of our programs. I've been here for 13 years, and some of the programs just kind of started up because there was funding, which is not the way to go when you're in a nonprofit. But others, you know, they've been going on for so long that we want to make sure that we take a step back for a quick second, and we look at those outcomes, those measurement tools, and that we're actually looking forward and making sure that we're meeting those targets based on what we felt our goals were at the beginning of the year. And so again, this framework will be used throughout all seven of our programs, and it's very user-friendly, very adaptable, and it keeps us on track. So it goes kind of back to what Jim was talking about. I mean, this is an organization that has strategic planning, contingency planning, scenario planning, and I think this is probably the first step to all of that. So it's never too late, and great if you're starting a new program, you know, grab this framework, but if you have an existing program that's been going on for years, again, never too late to step back and just kind of ground yourself and see where that foundation lies.
Great, so that, we kind of flew through what we wanted to talk about with you today, but we are hoping that we can kind of engage with you all and have a conversation about what we just talked about. If any of you have once again gone through this process, if you know, have found it useful and how you were able to use that information, if there are any questions for any of us up here as well, we're more than happy to take those. And I can pass this around too so that people can hear. Any thoughts or questions, anything like I said last time that you found really interesting today? I know it's like and it's the afternoon, and everyone's like hot and needs the coffee. Yeah, go. time frame? So we started, I'm trying to remember. It's a really good Yeah, so just under a year, I believe. And it depends on how in depth we go too. So we work with a lot of organizations to actually start from the beginning, develop that evaluation framework, go through the data collection, analyze and report out the findings too. So that might be a lot longer process. But for this partnership, it was, yeah, just under a year.
And I will tell you, it took the same big thing during the holidays. It's pretty crazy for us. And so I think we started working in September, and then we were like, let's wait until January for the organizational capacity survey. We'd already done the groundwork in terms of what we were going to ask, but we didn't really send it out until late January, early February. And so a lot of that just has to do with what you guys have going on within your organization, but developing the tool, I think it definitely could have gone a lot faster had we, you know, not had a holiday food drive between November and mid-January.
Yeah.
Do you want me to speak loud?
I can
do that. I have a handful of questions. So one is about selection of indicators and then tools. It sounds like you created all of your own assessment tools versus using already established tools that exist. And I'm kind of wondering how that decision was made versus, you know, there are capacity assessments that already are kind of tried and true that are out there. And then also in terms of selection of indicators of measuring the impact of these programs, whether you look to, you know, things like sustainable development goals and other kind of global measurements and indicators that are, you know, in our medium that already are being used by other groups as kind of a point of comparison versus just measuring your own program and your own goals. And then finally, in terms of baseline data, because it sounds like this is something that you kind of started and stopped in a short time period, and obviously baseline would have been many, many moons ago for this organization. Kind of, did you look to data that they already had on hand to kind of use as baseline, or did you just have a fixed time period that you were measuring change and impact in?
Okay, so good question. So, yeah. So, yeah. Let me see. You'll have to remind me if I miss any of it. So, for the last question, so we haven't actually started measuring, they haven't actually started collecting data. So the main goal of this process was to develop that framework so that they could start thinking through it and collecting data. So Callie does have data that she's been collecting, so there is some baseline data, but the reason she wanted to kind of go through this process is because the measures were those that were just developed by the organization with little kind of backgrounds going into developing. But we did pull measures from other standard tools that are then incorporated into that survey. So some of the fruit and vegetable consumption questions came from, I can't remember which ones we ended up using, but potentially the behavioral risk factor surveillance survey. So a lot of these surveys that are already have these very standard tried and true questions that would work with this program. So Callie and Danielle are going to start using these to start collecting data that they maybe weren't collecting before, and so we'll start to have some baseline information, some kind of pre-information going forward. Callie will still be able to compare it to some of the information that she has, but there will be new questions on the survey. And I think I missed one. I think, if there are things that have been used in the field that are also kind of, so we did a literature review of, you know, looking at other programs and nutrition education specifically for seniors, and there aren't a ton of programs with data out there on these measures for seniors, and these are meant to be very kind of concise, quick surveys, whereas if you're doing an intensive research study looking at nutritional outcomes, some of those surveys get, you know, very long and intense. So this was meant to kind of have a snapshot of what these programs are doing rather than an intensive kind of survey. And then going from there. So it's starting here and then seeing if we need to collect some more detailed information moving forward. Did that answer all of your questions? More or less?
I have one.
We can chat afterwards too if you if you'd like. Anything else you want to add on to that?
Yeah. So as Marty said, we do have some of these new tools that they adapted for our programs. They were also able to give us the scan of lit reviews that they did. So not only do we have these measures that we saw on the screenshot there with that survey, we have all their research that they did as well. So we can adapt that further to other programs down the line if we need to, and always come back to that literature review to ground ourselves in that foundation of evaluation.
The only thing I will add, we do not like to reinvent the wheel at all. I know when I started the Food for Kids backpack program back in 2006, I had heard about it at a conference in Chicago, and there were other food banks that were already doing the similar program. And so we want to learn from those experiences and take, in fact, a lot of our initial the referral form that the teachers and the school nurses are using to bring a child onto the program and identify them as chronically hungry. We did not create that material ourselves. That was created by a different organization in Oklahoma. That you know was backed by nutrition experts, folks in the academic field. So again, we do not like to reinvent the wheel, but we do understand that as time comes, these programs need to be adapted. And I think that this was the perfect time. You have Food for Kids that's been on board since 2006. Even our nutrition education program had been on for just a few years. And so it's just it's always good to stay in the know and have that opportunity to adapt and challenge yourselves with new questions, new ideas for those existing programs. So yeah, even now, even though we've already gone through this process, we're still willing to listen and hear what other forms of measurement and other leading factors are out there for these programs.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say, two things, that it was very specific to these programs. Part of that being, I think, funding what they're looking for in this nutrition education program, so making sure that we're measuring things that are being taught in the program. And then also, this is supposed to be kind of a sharing, engaging seminar. So if there are things that you can think of that you're using that are out there that would be useful for these programs, please do, let us know. I have my card, and Vanessa, of course, Callie or Danielle are more than happy to look at that information as well. And especially, in San Diego, if people are doing similar work or collecting similar information, it really helps show the overall impact. Yeah.
Are there other companies who do research like this that publish their data about organizations all over the country and what their impact has been?
Yeah, so...
Or is it mostly internal?
So it depends. I think it depends on the funding. A lot of organizations that get funding from the CDC or government have to have an external evaluator doing evaluation reporting back to their funder. I think a lot of this also with receiving funding from foundations. Some organizations want to use the information for their strategic planning and thinking about how to improve their programs. A lot of organizations that we work with do publish the information on their websites or as part of their grant, it's available. So I think it depends.
You have to search individually. There's not kind of a clearinghouse of successful best practices.
Different question. Is there a clearinghouse for successful best practices for programs? Are you talking specifically about food, hunger programs, food programs?
Yeah, why not?
If there is a clearinghouse for best practices. I'm not sure. I mean, there definitely are, and I can just say from background in public health that there are, the CDC has a ton of information about literature, about programs that, have been validated, that are successful. They even rank them on different levels of, how much information is backing up what you're doing. I'm sure there's something that is related to food insecurity and hunger programs, but nothing that I'm aware of. Yeah. So I think it depends on the organization and their internal capacity to do that. So a lot of times we do work with organizations to take on that next step. We collect the data, we analyze the data, we develop the report.
in the end. I know that Callie and Danielle have been collecting and reviewing a lot of their own data. And I don't know if you want to speak to anything else as far as like reporting outcomes or reports that you develop.
We did do this for the Food for Kids Backpack Program. We had a pre and a post test, which was basically using the referral form that the teacher was submitting at the beginning of the school year, and then kind of resubmitting it again at the end of the school year to see where the child fell. Did they improve in attendance, academics, how is their emotional behavior? And we found that in the post, it was not very different. And that's because a lot of the kids are kind of all in the same boat. They're, you know, food insecure. These are very low-income families, and there's a lot of other factors involved. Now, with the survey that was created through all of the data and research that they did, I think there's going to be a significant change, improvement, better improvement than what we gathered in the survey that we had done before. So I'm really excited. Individual child change.
Yeah, and we'll be measuring aggregate data, so we won't pinpoint it specifically to different seniors that are in our program. We look at the whole in terms of our nutrition education program that we just discussed. And also, for the scope of what we're doing, Excel or Google Docs, when you're using those analytics, is fine for what we need to report back. We're not to the level that we need specific SPSS or SAS or different data analyses. So when we do get all that raw data in, if you can build out your Excel doc to, you know, do all the equations for you, that's really helpful as well. And then when you think about all the questions that you are asking on your evaluation tool, making sure that you are asking only the questions that you need. Otherwise, you're going to get an influx of data that you, it's just going to sit there. Yeah, it might not be necessary. You may not actually be utilizing that. So you can always go back and reassess that as well if you are ending up with pools and pools of data.
But it actually really helps to know your objective. So what is the objective of your program? And so having very clear objectives, and then when you create the survey for the evaluation, is looking at those objectives and making sure that the questions kind of fall under those objectives.
Yeah, so I think it depends on the capacity of the organization, kind of what level of measurement needs to happen. But you know, there are always external organizations that can help you if there's the funding and resources available to do that kind of heavy lifting, collecting the data. If you do want more complicated analyses, that is something, you know, we can do and many other organizations can do. But I know there's not always the time and funding for that, so trying to figure it out internally is definitely a different process. Yeah.
As Jim mentioned, we rely heavily on our volunteers. Not only do they help out here in the warehouse, they definitely help move my programs forward as well. So in the past, we've trained students to help us teach the curriculum. We can put them through a training process. We have detailed instructor guides that will help them teach the senior classes that we're doing, the 6-week-long classes. And we also recruit student teachers to do one-time nutrition education. So going to some of our distribution sites and passing out those recipes, making a little sample, doing a little health education demo. So yes, we do utilize a lot of student interns as well. So if you have any, send them my way. We like the free labor. Yeah.
We like
the
labor. Yeah.
At least on the senior nutrition program, we have some demographic questions on there to take that into consideration. Right now, there is an English and Spanish version of the survey. Yeah, so the new one needs to be translated, but there are at least English and Spanish for that survey. I believe for Food for Kids Backpack, do you have materials and surveys in Spanish as well? So I think that is, I don't know your other language.
Yeah, that's the extent for these two programs. With other programs, we've, I know with our City Heights project, we have it in multiple languages, just the materials that we're handing out. But going back to the organizational capacity assessment, one of the results that came back from that was to actually diversify all of our materials that are going out to the public. So that is one of the next steps that has landed into our strategic plan that wasn't really there before. And so we're going to be focusing a lot more on translating more and more of those documents that we're handing out to the community.
Yeah, so she said the question was about language and culture. So definitely good point for the classes. I think they target a specific, and I don't know if you have targets for your classes of who's participating in the senior education or nutrition education programs. Yeah. So oftentimes it depends on who the program is targeting, but I think when you're doing nutrition education or you're providing examples for food, you know, demonstrations, are you including, I think that's a question, diverse, you know, cultures and ideas as you're doing that?
So other nutrition education programs that we do or one-off education series that we do, we try to implement culturally specific recipes or nutrition education. I know currently there's a new initiative called My Plate, My State. Has anyone heard of that yet? My Plate is trying to encourage different views of their traditional food group plate. And so having different cultures represented on that My Plate so you can better connect with the people that you're serving to say, you know, maybe it's not rice, but maybe it's pasta, or I don't even know, some other sort of different grain or different food that you can connect with them, because food is a really great way to connect with folks. So when you can tailor that education specific to the culture that you're speaking to, your outcomes will be even greater. I hope that your impact will be even greater. Currently, we're not evaluating that to that level of detail. I'd like to in the future. So great suggestion. So hopefully we can get to that point.
Yeah, and I think the Food for Kids Backpack Program, you know, it depends on the demographics of the schools that they're working at, really. And it's very diverse and, you know, across the county. And so the food that's given out at those programs is very standard at all of the schools. Is that right? And we are more than happy to continue that conversation because I know it's important, and since we're in the infancy of this partnership and kind of thinking about programs and measuring them, I think hearing that from you guys and making sure that we, you know, it always is something that we're thinking about, especially at Harder+Company. So I think bringing that up and having that conversation with us is great, so we appreciate that.
Yeah, and I think on the food bank then, you know, we are subject to the donations that we receive. And so I think oftentimes we go to areas and we're like, and you're asked for certain items, not just culturally sensitive items, but also just people who have special diets. You know, they ask for Ensure, they ask for different items that sometimes we cannot provide because we're at the mercy of our donors. But we do have a very small budget for food, and so we're being a lot more cautious with how we spend those dollars. We've talked a diabetic-friendly box that we would be able to send out, a gluten-free box that we'd be able to send out, but all of that would come with additional funding because we're not going to be able to sustain that with just receiving in donations. So that's another piece of it. When you're a nonprofit, you are subject to what's coming through. But with our nutrition policy and limiting what you know, those unhealthier products, we're doing a lot better because healthy fruits and vegetables, as Jim mentioned, is one of our biggest pushes, and that's something that will fit all demographics, all cultures, and anyone that's on a special diet as well.
Any additional questions or thoughts? Yeah, we got three. We'll start over here. Okay.
When are you looking to start using the Cooking Matters programming? And do you have a specific geographic area that you're hoping to launch that in?
So our Cooking Matters partnership, we're starting to pilot a class this fall so we can kind of see where we need to be, get our feet under us, and then hopefully by the start of next spring, so January, February, we'd love to reach out to our agency partners if they would like to host a class or if we can come and facilitate that for them. So that's kind of our time frame that we're looking at. We still have specific funding for this program, so that's another issue. We're trying to work on the sustainability of this. and keeping costs low for us and our agencies that are hosting the classes or the grocery store tours. So that's kind of the short answer of that. But I can definitely talk to you about that after as well.
Actually, I just had a comment just to say that the importance of compelling evaluation, not obviously to funding for sure, but also to program partners. We actually partner with the food, Sharp Healthcare, we partner with the food bank on the senior nutrition program. And in the beginning, there were a couple of metrics that focused on behavior change. So it was really cool to see with this new survey, not only the greater focus on behavior change, but also on food insecurity in general. That's the type of information that's really compelling to bring back to leadership to expand a partnership and to strengthen it. So thank you guys for doing that. It's really exciting.
Great addition over here.
I was wondering, I guess, if you have a process for gathering qualitative data, like through interviews, and what your thoughts are on the value of doing something like that?
Yeah, qualitative data is equally as important as quantitative data in many, for many programs, and I think especially for these. So that's interviews or focus groups, working with people and hearing from them how these programs have impacted them. So we have some open-ended questions on the surveys, which kind of will get at a little bit of that. For the Food for Kids backpack programs, one of the ideas we've thrown around is having focus groups with parents and students to hear from them about how satisfied they are with the program, what has the impact been, because there's only so much we can gather by asking multiple choice questions or yes or no questions. So that is something we've talked about specifically with the Food for Kids backpack program. I don't think we went into as much detail on the senior nutrition program about that, but I think it brings up a great point for the food bank to consider and keep thinking about. But we value qualitative data, just as much as quantitative, so it's really important and interesting. Anything else? What's that? Yes, please.
I'm just very happy to hear that you're sort of moving your focus more on food nutrition rather than just the food bank, and that you're not accepting sugary drinks anymore. So your donors know that your focus now is more on nutritional food for the community. It's very happy to hear.
Anything else? Any other? Yeah.
I think someone mentioned about this going into other programs. So obviously, there's 400 plus partners with the San Diego Food Bank. We get a 1-1. And so we've been challenged year over year, just kind of at an individual level, to increase poundage and increase people that we're serving. And so one of the questions that I know a lot of different agencies like ours is asking is, are we making a difference in telling our volunteers, people inside our organizations, is there a plan to kind of have this trickle down to that program level? And if so, kind of timetable, plan, any way that we can jump in and help?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And Shelly's our manager of our nonprofit services, so she's hearing this for the first time. But one of the things that we'd like to do, in addition to pulling out this framework down to all of our existing programs, is as part of Food Bank University, Jim mentioned, we'll do all sorts of different workshops. We want to kind of train you all as well from what we learned, and we can go a little bit more into detail in terms of what were the materials that were used, how did we go through the research. This was more on the 10,000 foot level, but that's definitely something that we recognize a lot of people want to learn more about. We ourselves, when we started our nutrition policy, for example, we had people say, well, wait a minute, if you're not collecting soda and energy drinks, that's a lot of weight. So are our pounds going to go down? And it's not about pounds, it's about nutrition. And so we were willing to sacrifice, £1 million or whatever that number would be to gain better products for our clientele. So we recognize that this is something that we should share with everyone, and that's one of the reasons why we wanted to do this presentation today with Alliance Healthcare. But we will definitely make this a part of one of our future Food Make University courses, and maybe it will trickle into our next hunger conference as well.
Any other thoughts or questions?
Thank you so much. I want to thank Nancy, Michelle, Alliance Healthcare, Harder Company, staff, more importantly, all of you guys for showing up today. This was not planned, but if any of you want to stay, I'll be glad to give a tour of the warehouse if you haven't had that. So I have a freezer unit that's 10 below and refrigeration that's 40. So you know, if you want to cool off, I can help you with that too. So thanks for being here.
Thank you.